To serve the Lord. Isn't it a great day today with the beauty of the sun, the strong current of air coming down from the sun, the light rays that come down to heal us, to give us vitamin D, and to give us healing from the COVID, to make it end. And I believe it's going to end, don't you?
Amen.
I believe it's going to end. We believe that. I want to have prayer right now. This is a prayer time. And in this prayer time today, there are several people that I want you to remember. Number one, I want you to remember Mr. Steve Inman. Now, Steve doesn't go to church here, but he's close to us. And I want to pray that God is going to heal his body from cancer and make him whole in Jesus' name. I know you're going to believe it with me. The second thing I want to pray about is Ron Simpson, who has had another bout with some clots, something that has stopped him temporarily after the knee surgery. But he's going to be fine, we believe. The third thing I want you to pray about will be the Milburn family. Last Sunday, I mentioned to you that their daughter was having surgery out in Oakland, California, at Stanford University Hospital. Well, let's just say that things transpired and it didn't get better. And little Stacy, on her birthday, 33 years old, went to be with the Lord. They are preparing her to come back here, and we'll let you know about the service, although it will be a private type of service at the cemetery. But I want you to remember Joel and Jean and all of their family. It's quite a time now. You know, it really is a sad time sometimes when you have the kids to die and you know that 30 some years ago you lifted them up before the Lord and dedicated them. And then to do their funeral services makes it a very tough time. I want you to remember the Milburn family. And I know that you have requests for prayer. Let this place become a prayer ground right now. And I want you not to listen to anything else but me right now, and as I lead us in prayer. And I want us to pray that God is going to meet these needs and meet your needs. Some of you are sick. I realize that. I want you to just touch yourself and anoint yourself. There's no distance in prayer as we speak the word of faith to you. Now, Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day that we can keep holy. I want to thank you, Lord, because you made the Sabbath day for us. And I pray, Spirit of God, that you will let this day be holy unto us, one that we will never forget on Memory Sunday, Memorial Day Sunday. Lord, let our minds be flooded with nostalgic things of the past. For Lord, we can make our future no brighter and bigger than we can remember our past. Lord, we pray for Mr. Inman, that you will touch his body and heal him. We speak the word today of healing for him. For you, Mr. Inman, that God will touch you and make you whole. We speak the word of faith for Ron Simpson, in Jesus' name, be made whole. We speak the word of faith for a bereaving family, the Milburns, Gene and Joel, in the absence of young Stacy. Lord, we pray that you will heal them. And let us be able to send cards and calls and emails to let them know that we're in the fight with them. Lord, we thank you for each person here. Now, Lord, we know that in every car there is a major need. It's why we've come to church, Lord. We've come to church, Lord, because we know that you know how to meet needs. And as we stand and as we sit, Lord, we pray that every prayer and every word will bring glory unto you and healing. We pray in the name of Jesus our Lord. And God, when we come to the point where we pray for the nation and we pray for those who have given their lives, those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice, we pray, Lord, that our hearts will be open and that we will remember and never forget. We pray it in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And everybody said amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory. It's good. Let's praise him. Amen. Express yourself. Now you're still coming in. They are still coming in with your radios tuned to 92.7. And we want you to be ready to stay with us for just a few minutes. And at the end, don't just leave out if you don't mind. You can get out real easy. Believe me, everything is fine. And I'm sorry? You okay? Okay. I want you to join me in welcoming the visitors. Now, in a moment, we're going to clap for them. But right now, let me say that some of you are here for the first time. Others, I see you've come up to me, close to me, and you've spoken to me. Some of you come to the drive-through on Wednesday at 12, as it will be this week also. And we will pray for you, and we're seeing needs met there. And I want to thank you for being here. And I want to thank you for being so regular in your attendance, regular in your offerings, regular in your support and your prayers. And if you are here today, and it is your first Sunday at Northwood, I want you to make a picture or call our office and let us know your name and address and telephone number so that we can send you a hot, delicious pizza this week. It's compliments of us just to let you know that we appreciate you being in church today with us. That's first time visitors today. So make a selfie, if you will. Send it into northwoodtemple.org, and or send it through the telephone system, 488-7474, and we're going to have a pizza sent to you this week. God richly bless you. Tell us what kind you love, too, if you will, okay? And we'll do our best to do that. Now, they're still coming in, and so we want to say for all of our visitors today and for everybody, welcome to the service today. Let's make them welcome. Come on. Praise the Lord. Now, just before I preach and speak to you today, it will be just a message, but not a preaching. On Memorial Sunday, things that I am thankful for, I'm going to ask Brooke and Pam and Chuck to come back and sing this great song that I asked them to sing. It's one of the best ones for me. And it doesn't just pertain to Memorial Day, but it's things that we remember. And I want you to sing it with them, okay? I want you to be right into it with them and let everybody worship now.
Said you love me. would never leave me.
Did you enjoy that? Come on. I want to hear you all around. They're still coming. Thank you, Chuck. Give us a great song, Chuck. Oh, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. One of my favorites. One of my favorites. I want to remember. And on this day, we remember. It's a day, Memorial Day. Is one of the favorite days of mine because we set aside one day in the United States to turn our thoughts to the past and collect our memories about those who have paid a great price so that we could be here today and we could have our freedoms. And we have those freedoms, and it's because somebody has paid a price for them. And hallelujah for those who have done that. But today, however, I want us not only to remember those who have paid the price in the military. I want us to pay the price for some others also, and some other things. I like what the group sang when they said, "I will remember the work of your hands." Do you ever stop to think about the work of the hands of the Lord? Can you see how great He has been to our country? I'm not bragging about it, but I have traveled and preached in about 48 countries around the world. I've ridden on boats, canoes, puddle hoppers, everything you can, camels, donkeys, razorbacks, and horses. I've seen everything to the Taj Mahal, all around the world of these beautiful things. But I have yet to see anything as beautiful as the United States of America. Can I hear an amen from somebody? Glory! I thank Him for the work of His hands, who has made a universe for us and placed us on this planet right here, 25,000 miles around it in circumference. Speeding at 1,000 miles an hour from east to west, I think. Amazingly, it stays on course. 23.5 degree axis and never varies. Maybe something in a million years. I thank Him for making the sun. That 93 million miles from here, right here, this sun right here, never runs out. It reminds me of the Son of God, whose love never runs out for us. Can I hear an amen from somebody? Glory, hallelujah. We think about it being so close right here. And it is close and wonderful to me, even though it makes you sweat. Sweating's good for you. But it takes the light from that sun 8 seconds, leaving the sun's surface to get to you and me right here. That's how fast light travels at 186,000 miles per second. And that's how far we are from these, and this is our closest star, this sun. They're out there 450 billion light years away from us. Some, we've never received the light from them yet. God has made it all for us. He's made the angels a little lower than we are and made us a little bit higher because we're the only ones who can be thankful for the experience of being a forgiven sinner, ready to go to heaven. Can I hear an amen from that? Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. I thank him for this country itself. And it seems that he has blessed this country with more natural beauty than any other that I've ever seen. You can go from the beaches of Moorhead and Wrightsville and Myrtle and New Jersey and New York all the way to the beaches of the great Pacific, from blue to great. You can go from the Gulf Stream waters all the way to Canada and see lakes that have hardly ever been fished on. You can find the beauty if you go west and you get to Albuquerque, New Mexico. You will never experience a sunset like the sunset at Albuquerque, New Mexico. It's colossal to see it, to say the least. You will never see anything any more beautiful than to be in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, and look up to the west and see the beautiful Grand Teton Mountains with the snow caps on them. They're beautiful. Or to ride a raft on the Snake River and see a moose protecting her little mises, or whatever you call little mooses. It's beautiful to see it. Or to go through the Grand Canyon and walk through or drive through the Painted Desert in Arizona and the Petrified Forest. And to go to California and see the great giant redwood forest. They don't grow anywhere else in the world like they do there on the Pacific Coast. It is something to see. You have yet to see it until you go to see the tall timbers of the giant sequoias. Or if you didn't want to do that, you could find the natural beauty right here in North Carolina. You could see the beautiful lakes and the mountains. And you could go on Grandfather Mountain. And you could see all of the Blue Ridge Parkway. And when you get to Virginia, you could see the Luray Caverns that he made, where I spent a day or two of my honeymoon there. I'm telling you, folks, it's the most gorgeous place. God has made it all. I will remember the things that he has made with his hands. It's okay, go ahead. Will you remember? Let's do it. I will remember what God has done for this country. Now, there are some who could care less, probably, what God has done to this country. And some who would no doubt like to undo it. But they're not going to be able to. I want to tell you what God has given to us when you think that you find it somewhere else. We have, as a country, the largest steel production in all of the world. America has the greatest transportation system of all of the countries throughout on the planet. The U.S. has more beautiful homes than anywhere else, and you can find great ones right here in Fayetteville, Cumberland County, North Carolina. We have more care for the aged. And I think about what has happened recently with some of them putting the COVID-19s in with our care for the aged. And many of them dying. But we've got a beautiful adult care system. I myself had a sister-in-law to die yesterday in my hometown of Henderson. My oldest brother's wife. She stayed in the nursing home for over 25 years, the same one, and they cared for her. And Jose Hedgepeth is dead at the age of 101, she lived a rich life. We say congratulations to her and her transport to heaven today. I heard her sing The Man of Galilee. I love that Man of Galilee. It'll turn you on anytime. And it was her son that I went out to Tucson to lead to the Lord. About 5 years ago, 3 years ago, and he accepted the Lord. And then a month later, I went back on my own and did the funeral. And 65 people gave their hearts to Jesus Christ. All of them were retirees, and they gave their heart to Christ. We have the best hospitals that you can find anywhere in the world. You got Duke. You've got Chapel Hill, Wake, Rex, all of these great hospitals. You've got MD Anderson and the Mayo Clinic and Stanford and all of these great hospitals. We are blessed. And we are blessed in this triangle right in this area to have the hospital systems that we have, aren't we? I thank God for them and because they believe in Christ. And soon I will go into one of the hospitals and I will have surgery in the next 10 days. Maybe I'll walk straighter then. You'll have prayers for me, I know. And it's okay, go ahead, it's fine. Never halfway. This country, I thank him because we are leaders in research. You may not be aware of it, and you may, but the Nobel Prize is received by 50% of the Nobel Prizes are received by men and women from this country right here because they engage in technology and in science that gives you a longer life. And one day, when this younger crowd that's 18, 20 years old, when they get as old as I am, the lifespan will not be 82. The lifespan may be a 90, 95 because of what they're doing. If we can only be smart in what we're doing, folks. But God has given us a brain, and we have to use that brain. And we shall not tempt the Lord thy God. That's what he says. Jesus said it. You and I know what I'm talking about. We found more cures for diseases than anybody on the planet. And Israel is next in that. America comparatively is small to all the other great nations, but it has more of the wealth of all of the nations put together. America has more aliens, listen to this, defecting to us, climbing walls, crawling under, coming over in parachutes, coming by the right way, than any nation in the world. Why would they want to come to America? Because America is a place where you can be as great as you want to be, or you can be as little as you want to be. We don't have any of our people hardly defecting to their countries. They're all wanting to come to this land. This land is my land. This land is your land. From the Gulf Stream waters to Canada, all the way from Wrightsville Beach to Los Angeles, it's my country and your country. Let's blow our horns together and praise the Lord for this country. Glory. Now, I know some people would probably say, you're just bragging a lot. I am. I want you to know that, and you're smart. That's why everybody's coming here, and we're glad. And in our church right here, we have got some of the smartest people who've come from other countries. They've become lawyers and doctors and research scientists because they believe that America, you could get it right here. Who made it possible for us to have this? It was God, our Father. We have free enterprise. You don't like free enterprise, you don't have to do anything. You can wait for Social Security, or you can be in free enterprise the way you like. We have more missionaries going out than any other country in the world. We have more major colleges and universities. Look at how many we have. Let me give you one in particular. May I? Let me give you one that was started as a Christian school. It was called Harvard. It was originally founded so that men and women could go, and men mainly at the time, could go and practice and learn to be a pastor and a minister. It's hardly recognized for that anymore. But it's noted for its great research. And when a person matriculates to Harvard, they leave with a great education. Many leave with more than an education. It's believed in by people around the world. There's actually one country in the world on this planet today that sent hundreds of their young people to Harvard to be educated. And instead of staying in the United States with their brain power, they're called right back to their country, by the hundreds every year. And they go and become scientists and professors and teachers and leaders. And I might say to you, that country that is doing that today is none other than the one who transported the COVID-19 to us, communist China. They see the value of our schools. They see the value of your institutions. They see the value of your churches. They'd love to have it, but they don't. You have been the recipients of the greatest God who ever lived, our God Almighty. And that's why we give him praise and we give him thanks today for how good he is. And today we will remember those who gave their lives so that we could be free. This will be short and very concise, but I want you to remember it. In the first war of major importance was the Revolutionary War. We sacrificed 25,324 men and women to get the freedom we've got, to get the Bill of Rights, to get the First Amendment, to get the Second Amendment, to be where you are. You understand? You say, John, you get really excited about it. I do. I'm a free man today because 25,324 men said, we'll sacrifice everything to make him free. That's why you're here today. That Civil War came along about 80 years later. We lost more in that Civil War, 498,000, almost a half a million cousins killing cousins. Then came World War I, that campaign. We lost 116,710 people. Then came Second World War, which was a great, great war. We lost 407,316 people in World War II. Then came the Korean conflict. Many of you were there. We lost 54,546. Then came Vietnam, that thankless war, where people came to this city right here and burned their undergarments in the public, where our boys were dying in the jungles of Vietnam. I can't get used to it. You may, but I don't get used to it. I'm thankful to those guys who did it. And we lost then 58,000 men, 58,098. Then came Gulf War and the Iraqi War, 293 and one, 819 and then others since then. One soldier, they said an unknown soldier, in one of those crosses today around the world, maybe in Flanders Fields, maybe in Germany, maybe at Iwo Jima or Hawaii. Dig him up. And if you could ask him one question, my question would be, looking around and seeing everything that you see right here and the way we've taunted you and others, would you do the same thing over again? And he'd say, I would do the same thing over again. Because he's my American hero. I remember him today. Even though he doesn't have a name, God knows where he is today. And I want you to sound off with him right now. Around this world. Come on. And today we remember those who have died in COVID-19. I call it a war. Friday, it was 95,496. This morning, it's right at 96,000 in the United States who have died. The war isn't over yet. We think it's over, but it's not over. We've got to use our brains, just as you would if you had malaria or whooping cough or polio, so that we don't infect anybody else. And we're such people who are so gregarious that we want to be with somebody. When I see you, I want to rub and up and hug you. One woman hugged herself just now. Look, we're made to be together. I know that, but you're made also to protect one another. And that's why we want to practice the social distancing until it goes down and down and we lick this thing. If not, we'll have another one. And we must be very careful about it. I wouldn't say anything if I didn't mean it. We remember those who have died. We say, God bless you, Americans. And may God bless every family who's connected with you. And last I say, I will remember the day that he saved me. I have the date, March the 12th, 1955. I was just almost about a 13, 14-year-old boy. Now you know the age. If you do health and arithmetic pretty good, you'd get it, okay? But I'm telling you, I haven't been perfect. I've made so many mistakes, enough to ruin a church, ruin a diocese or a conference, ruin a life. But God in his infinite love loves me. And he says, listen, I forgive you. And that's the way he is today. I've never gotten over being saved. Have you been saved so that you can say, I thank him for the day that he saved me, made me one of his children so that I could have everlasting life? I know I'm going to heaven. Do you know you're going to heaven? I ask you, honk it if you do. Glory. If you do not, I'm going to have to depend that you're going to call me or you're going to write me or tell me sometimes. We're going to pray right now. And I want you to do it, just like Billy Graham says it, just like Franklin says it, just like I've said it for many years. I want everybody here in your cars to repeat it after me. My dear Lord God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for giving your son to die for me. I confess my sins because I can't save myself. Forgive me today and give me this gift of everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. Now, if you did that, all I ask you to do, I'm not going to come and try to jump on you or get you up in church and let you preach or anything like that. I just want to know. I want to know where you are. Now, while I'm here for a moment, I want to say one other thing to you. It's really important. It's going to be a couple of things if you don't mind, okay? But I really want to say this to you today. You've been very faithful to come to the drive-in church. But the president, this week, this Friday, Thursday, whatever, he said we're going to open our churches back up, and the governor says it's okay. And we are going to open up Northwood Temple next Sunday morning, listen, on Pentecost Sunday! Pentecost Sunday is 50 days after the atonement, after the death on the cross. 50 days after. We're going to have a time with singing. The choir is going to be there. They're going to be distant. They're going to set the example for you. And we're going to rope off some pews. Now, we're going to have instructions there in the newsletter this week. You got to read the newsletter. When you get here, you'll see some place to wash your hands. We'll have the stuff for you to do it. We want to make sure that you don't get it from someone else. You'd say, well, I don't have anything, neither do I. That's what somebody thought this week. They stepped up to the counter. The woman was with her future son-in-law. They stepped up. He's nice as he can be, handsome as he can be. And they stepped up to the counter, and she bought a Coke and he bought a Pepsi. She reached down and grabbed his and he grabbed hers. And they had both drunk out of it. He went and got checked. And he was positive for the COVID-19. Now, this is the way it happens. You can say nobody's got it. But we're going to be careful with the offering. We're going to have walking offerings so that you don't touch the plate and 200 more do. We're going to do that. And we're going to ask families to sit together. That's the first thing. We want you to start near the front, not way back at the back. Sit together wherever there is a seat for you to sit. And if you pull in beside one of them, make sure you're 6 feet away before you sit down, okay? Because ushers will be there to say, I'm sorry, but we've got to subscribe to this and we've got to make sure that nobody is carrying it. You can be asymptomatic. You might not even know that you've got it, no symptoms at all, and you could carry it and give it to someone else. I know you read these things, but I've got to say it because I'm the preacher. Now, we're going to do that. The service is going to last 1 hour. You're timing me, Mike, okay? Phil, you're timing me. The service is going to last 1 hour, and that's, say it, everybody, come on, 1 hour. Because the longer you're there, the more chances you get. I'm going to ask you not to shake hands with people, not to run up and say, oh, and slob all over them and love them. I'm going to ask you to just do it at a distance. One day is coming, however, when you can love all you want to, okay? It won't be long if you will cooperate with me. I want them to know that we are smart right here. And we do like Jesus said when he said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And for me to say, well, it don't happen to me, boy, I'm telling you right now. It shows you that I am not like Jesus at all. You know, when the devil took him up and said, jump. And Jesus said, you shall not tempt the Lord God. Now, there are some things that I'm asking you to do, and I'll ask you more. And we can get about 218 people in this church on the bottom floor. It seats 1,200 to 1,300, but you can't get them because we have to be one seat away fill this seat or put some on this seat, skip the next one. They'll be roped off so you can't get in. Don't go and pull the tape down now, okay? I ask you for your cooperation, and I ask you to let's make it the greatest day we've ever had when we're coming back together. Now, look. Go ahead. You started. Can we do it? And others have said, I don't like coming to drive-ins. They hadn't been yet. They said, I love inside first. I don't know how you'd say compare it. But anyway, I want you to know something. I love outside. And I got an idea. Maybe after we get clear of this thing and folks are not afraid to go and eat others' food, maybe we can tailgate one Sunday and have a big picnic right out here in the yard. How about that? Glory. Cook out. Can you handle it? Here's one of the cooks right here. We'll have hot dogs or something. We can do it, can't we? Maybe we'll have a hot dog eating contest. I want to do it. We'll do something to remember. Now, I want to ask you, can you help me do this? Can you understand what I'm doing and that it's only for our good? Can you do that? And when we get inside next week, one of the first things we're going to do going back into the church on Pentecost Sunday, we're going to have Holy Communion. We've got the little things so that you don't have to have anybody touching it. And you can do your own. And we're going to have Holy Communion, and it will be shouting time. And you're going to shout like you blew your horns. Amen. Now, if I'm off base, you can come and tell me. But if you'll cooperate with us next week in what I'm asking you to do, I want you to give a loud clap of your horn right now. Let me see if you'll cooperate with us, can you? I vote. It's unanimous, don't you think? It's unanimous. Now, I want you to try to come early if you can. If your tendency is to come late, come on early so you can get on into it and get everything in for 1 hour, okay? And we'll tell you what you can do there, and we'll have people set up so that if there are emergencies, we can meet those emergencies. Amen. Now, I want ushers to move among you and give you an opportunity right now to give your offering. And I'm going to ask this group to sing for you. It's a great song. You won't want to move for this now, if you don't mind. Because this song is God Bless America. Will you roll your windows down? And usher's going to don't leave until they come by you. And they're going to move from end to end. So let's do that. Somebody over on this side. Are they here, Mike? Okay. We need the man on this side over here. Okay. All right. Now, I want you to sing with me. Sing it 2 or 3 times if we have to. Okay.
Thank you.
Now, God, we pray that you will bless those who have fallen, those families that we remember today. Put us in remembrance, Lord, of the price that has been paid to make us free. May we never forget that, Lord, we pray. Lord, may you bless this country, bless our president. Lord, we pray that peace will be on our land. And we pray that you will bless us, Lord, as we make the transition now to go back into church next Sunday at 10 o'clock. And everybody said amen. God bless you. Let's go with care.